Okay, I'm gonna start streaming.
Yep.
Hello everyone and welcome to another Photo Mishmash. I'm Christina.
And I'm Toby.
And this is episode 51.
Live show. You guys are coming up with a title. Last week the title was Long Exposure Cockroaches. I think that might have been from Tanner. And that was a great title, except when the URL got shortened on Facebook and it became Long Exposure Cock. That's a different kind of show. We're not about that. So we gotta keep that in mind. I don't know what the URL limit is. I don't really care. It's kind of funny. So, and only one person commented on it. But keep your eyes out, keep your ears out for a appropriate show title, long or short, for episode 51. If you missed last week, you missed all of the celebration, the gigantic giveaways for episode 50, the birthday cake, the candles, the when your hair caught on fire. None of that happened. It was just episode 50. Took us a little over a year to get there, but now we're cruising along at a pretty regular pace. But speaking of that, before we forget, we will not be live next week. We're going to be doing some traveling, some time with family out in the Pacific Northwest. We're very excited about that, but it does mean we won't be bringing you a live show. There will still be some content coming out next week, but not a live mishmash. Sorry.
Yep.
Oh, and you know what? Let's play this. And now back to us. So, first thing we like to do is...
sponsors.
Yes. And we're done talking about this wonderful desk as a sponsor, but I'll just say that in the case you missed it part segment of this week, a full review with a little behind the scenes tour of this workspace went out. And you should check it out. This desk is a neat piece of both equipment and technology, and it feels so much healthier to spend part of the day standing. But as I said, they're not really one of the sponsors. It just is a cool thing. One of the sponsors is Squarespace, however, and there was a video put up today. So we're gonna be very brief about them as well. The frictionless way that Squarespace allows you to build an incredible looking website and blog is just fantastic. We'll say a little bit more a little bit later on. And then another sponsor, of course, is you all, you Patreon supporters. Thank you. Your contributions each month and the value you get in return have been really helping build this channel, and we're excited about some future developments that we have planned because of your support. So thank you.
Yep. And
I kept it brief.
You did keep it brief. That's right. Do we want to talk about Patreon as well?
I just did.
Oh.
That's how brief it was.
Wow.
You weren't paying attention.
So, the question of the week last week, if you could only shoot at two focal lengths for the next year, which two focal lengths would you choose? And the results were, dun, dun, dun.
Go ahead, you can say them.
Okay.
Are they written there?
Yeah. So, yeah, they're weird. 31.8 and 101.08 millimeters.
Huh. 100, what was the second one?
101? 181. Oh,
181. They are a little strange. That's because I took everybody's results. Next time I'm going to set up a poll for this because I manually entered into everybody's replies on Facebook, YouTube, and I guess that was just the two places. It sounded like more when I started saying them. And then averaged it because I took everybody's low answer and everybody's high answer or wider focal length and longer focal length, and then averaged them, and we got 31.87 and 181. Now, it was interesting to see some of the different responses in different places. A lot of people went for 24 for their wide. They could walk around for a year, have a wider focal length at 24. There were some people that, there were just a very few that went wider than that, and it seemed to me that those people were probably shooting on mirrorless. I think one person made mention like at 15, but I think they're a mirrorless shooter. So I don't know if they were always taking the crop factor into effect. This wasn't a completely scientific poll, but it was just fun. And then a lot of people in the 30 to 35-ish range, which I think personally That's what I had in mind when I was putting this together. I think I'd walk around at 35. I'd sacrifice a little bit of that wide for just a little bit nicer bokeh and more portrait type. Make an argument either way. And then on the long side of things, a lot of people were up at 85 in that general range. Then there was a handful at 200. And then there was a small handful way out at 600. And I think that has skewed our results higher than they would be otherwise. I could if I really wanted
somebody to. Somebody really said 640? That was somebody's answer.
No, somebody said 400 on a crop sensor.
Oh, okay.
So I put these all into full frame-ish when I could tell for sure that that's what they meant all the time. So I think if we took those high 600s out, that 181 went down into the neighborhood of around 100, 135, a lot of people said. Now, Christine, you were eager to give your answers last week. What were they? Can you share?
So I think I would pick 35 and 50, maybe.
35 and 50, no longer than 50.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. It all depends on what you like to photograph. I imagine the people that stuck 600 in there like to go out and shoot birds. So you'd be very happy going around shooting wide, you know, normal 35-ish, and then you go photograph some birds and you get to be at 600. That makes sense to me. So yeah, you don't do much wildlife.
Nope.
You would be probably, let's say you had to shoot a wedding at those two focal lengths. That might be a little awkward with the bride and groom kind of close up on the altar.
Yeah, I wouldn't get many close shots, but I wouldn't either with an 85. I mean, kind of, mm-hmm. but yeah. Not that much closer.
Right.
So.
Okay. So, there's a link to the spreadsheet if you want to take a look at it and its highly scientificness. I have no question of the week this week. I was trying to think of one briefly and I didn't. So if anybody comes up with a good one, we'll put it in at the end of the show notes. It's always kind of fun to think about something. And also, for those of you who didn't see on Facebook, it's fun to look at my comment log or number of comments on my videos. YouTube gives you a little chart of the last 28 days. And it goes along like this, and then you see a big peak. And it goes along like this, and a big peak. Each of those peaks is these live shows, because your live comments count as comments, or the chat counts as comments. And that, even though they disappear, the number gets counted. And so we have these fantastic peaks. And we almost have hit 1,000. So chat away. I don't mean don't be all spammy and stuff, but feel free to chat away. It'd be fun to hit 1,000 comments.
And try to keep the conversation on topic. I try to keep my eye on the chat to pick out some good questions, and so do Roy and Ruby. But it's really distracting when there are people are discussing things that aren't necessarily photography related or add to the conversation.
Their favorite pizza toppings, for instance?
Meh, that's all right. I'd be interested to find out what people's pizza toppings are. Sure.
Their favorite type of donut.
Yeah, how about that?
Okay.
Okay, so in case you missed it,
mm-hmm.
this week Toby released the NX1 review.
Yes, finally. Well, you know, first off, it always goes back to, do you count the start of the week as a Sunday or a Monday? You know, it depends. So it was out on Sunday, and I finally got that out. Took me a while. Go watch it. I think it's a good review. I tried to keep it brief, but man, when you want to cover a camera in detail, it takes a while to do that. I'll say in short that it is a fantastic camera. Awesome image quality when you get one of the good lenses. Very awesome performance, but it is pricey. I'm not saying it's not a good value, but it certainly is pricey. And the ecosystem is limited. Somewhat severely, depending on the type of photography you do or video. But, you know, since that review went out, I was chatting with a friend of mine who is a wedding videographer, a very good wedding videographer. He works in, he's starting to be part of this larger company that does very high-end wedding videography, beautiful stuff. They're switching to all NX1 gear from mostly 5D Mark III stuff.
Yep.
So I think that's really interesting and really telling. This is a dynamic camera that offers a lot of awesome features And if you're willing to like deal with some of the sacrifices, then it can be a great camera. Now, slightly related to this, I had a nice Twitter conversation with Dave Dugdale from Learning DSLRs this week, learningdslrvideo.com, I think. Mm-hmm. He's a nice guy.
He is.
And we were talking a little bit about feeling kind of disappointed in Canon, you know, with nothing on the horizon that is going to be awesome for video, for most people. And my concern that the 5D Mark IV is not going to have 4K video, that the reason why not, because they can't do it. Every time I say that, somebody says, oh, of course they can do it. Yes, of course they can do it. But marketing is going to be like, no, if we put 4K in that, no one's going to buy the cinema camera. So I think there's a real concern, worry here. I hope I'm wrong, and I think I might be wrong. I haven't decided yet. I keep hemming and hawing. But the people get into the Canon cinema line by starting at the 5D Mark III level or the 5D Mark IV level. And so if they don't make that compelling, the blue to be twofold. One, the people at the higher end going to these NX1s and things of that sort, and people at the lower end who would have bought into the Canon line but said, well, you know what, I'm going to go down this road instead and never get into that kind of product lineup. So he just made the point that that's how people start. They start at the 5D Mark III level. So if they cripple the 5D Mark IV, they're really going to hurt themselves. So that might be a good argument for the fact that they won't. But I don't know. Let's move on.
Yep. And here I see that Lightroom 6 was released, and we did a complete tour of the new features.
That's right.
Not.
I see now. I put that in there to see if Christina was paying attention, how much she was paying attention this week. Because I talked to her all week long, especially about Lightroom 6, because it was supposed to come out. Where is Lightroom 6? I don't know. It doesn't really matter. It'll be out when it'll be out. But we kept hearing from the rumor sites, March 9th, then March 20th, March 25th. I'll be honest, I even stayed up to midnight on March 24th. We're up kind of that late anyway. Eyes refreshing. Adobe, Twitter search, Lightroom 6, nothing. So it'll be out when it's out. What's interesting is all previous versions of Lightroom to now have had an open beta period of time.
Yep.
Where the new program is out and people can download it and use it for free and test it out and see if, you know, their catalogs will work well and all of that stuff. And not a peep. It's a little strange. While somebody's angry tweet at Adobe, how dare you? Where is Lightroom 6? Well, I mean, you know, they don't necessarily owe us anything the second.
Right.
Can't get feisty about it. Well, you can, but
they're definitely keeping it hush-hush, though.
They are. It's very hush-hush.
So, anyway. Another video that was released this week by us was episode 6 in our Lightroom series. And actually, you, Toby, did this one.
I did do this one.
So do you want to tell them a little bit about it?
Well, it's one of those things where, like episode 4 that I did, kind of the power tools, making Lightroom work efficiently for you. On the surface, it doesn't seem terribly exciting. This one, exporting and publish services. On the surface, it doesn't seem terribly exciting, but the power within the program and the knowledge with this video. Pause too long, it wasn't as smooth. I lost my train of thought. The power within this video that I teach you is pretty incredible. First off, there's all this confusion when you're exporting from Lightroom. Oh, what DPI? This person asked for 300 DPI. Oh, can I print large enough? And that is explained in the little document that comes along with it. It gives you a nice chart that is helpful in printing and exporting for print, exporting for sharing online. What size should files be? I give you my tips for Facebook. And some other popular social sharing sites so that you get the best quality from your prints. And burying the lead here, but the publish services is quite amazing. Did you know, for instance, that you can set up galleries on Facebook within Lightroom and drag and drop to upload to those galleries in Lightroom and see people's comments on Facebook in Lightroom and reply to them? And it's not just Facebook, Zenfolio, Flickr, all of these sites have these publishing services that allow you to connect and then do drag and drop. And that's not all. There's more.
There's more.
If you make changes to an image, a photo, you redevelop it. You can then re-upload it and it will replace what's up there. So you don't have to do this, oh, I gotta delete that one. You actually do still on Facebook. Facebook doesn't allow that type of connectivity, but Flickr, you just swap. Here's the good one. Here's the one after watching Christina's episode 3, I realized I can do this in editing. You fix it up and you just swap it. It's pretty slick.
Yep.
It's pretty powerful and it's just $2.50. And we're just a couple of episodes from being done. We've been saying about 8. I think that's where we're going to end up, give or take one or two. And the price will go up when all the episodes are released. I feel like this model has worked well for us, and I think we'll continue to do it with the next series as well.
Yep.
Okay.
So moving on to news.
News.
From Canon Rumors. Canon celebrates 12th straight year of number one share of global ILC market. It's pretty crazy. So how much of a lead do they have? Do you know?
That's a good question. And I want to ask my contact at B&H, but I bet they will not divulge that information. I would like to know what kind of lead they have. I think here in the U.S., it is, I don't want to say it's a double-digit lead, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's close. You know, for a long period of time, Canon has had the good point and shoots. And when many of you came to find me, you had a Canon point and shoot, and you were pretty sure that the next camera you wanted was a Canon DSLR, the Rebel series. So there's been this kind of this funnel. And Nikon, their point and shoots are much better in the last year or two, or even 3 years. But further back than that, they really weren't great. We're gonna have a guest here in a minute, I think. And they didn't have that funnel that worked well to bring people in to our system. Now, I'll compare this though with the Nikon D5500, just got DxO marked scored, and fantastic, best Nikon sensor to date. And I saw that in my review. I didn't match it up against every Nikon sensor ever, but I found its performance to be excellent. Very good. Very good. Yep. I saw somebody in the chat room ask if we're getting paid by Adobe. We're not getting paid by Adobe. I have an affiliation with Adobe in that if somebody will buy the Creative Cloud, I get a small percentage of the first month of that sale. But that is just something anybody can sign up for. And there's a cat on the table.
Yep.
Bean has made an appearance. So, thanks for that. It's a nice cat. Can we just like not make the butt be in front of everybody the whole time?
And from Photo Rumors, we've got some pictures of the new 4K Canon video camera, ? And some other pictures of Jackie Chan jumping on stage of the announcement. And basically taking the camera out of the...
Right. When I first read that, I usually scan my rumors late at night or early in the morning, and I think I was half asleep, and I was like, wait, did somebody try to jump on the stage and actually steal it? And then I realized it was Jackie Chan, and it was probably all part of the show. So here's what is coming at some point in the future. A 4K video camera from Canon that has a fixed lens and a 1-inch sensor. And we just got a couple pictures of it right here, not much at all. Actually, I thought I'd linked to Photo Rumors. So this seems, what people are saying is that it seems like it's going to be the camera used for drone videography. And that is certainly an exploding field. Is it a field that is big enough that Canon should... The first 4K consumer level camera that they release should be for drones? I don't know, but apparently they think so. Some people are saying this is going to come at NAB about 2 weeks. That's the National Association of Broadcasters, as we quizzed Christine on last week. And some people are saying not till May. So we'll see. We'll see.
We will see.
Mm-hmm.
And here we have an article from the...
John says if Jackie Chan tried to steal his camera, he'd let him. I would be bummed because he clearly has enough money to buy his own. But yes, that's true. Okay.
So next article is... title is Still Hoping for Future Kodak Moments. And basically, so there are a couple things about this particular article that you wanted to touch on, right, Toby?
Not actually. Oh. I was hoping you'd give a little perspective on film. And I just wanted to share with people my Squarespace video that went out today. This is where I got this idea. This is so neat. This is the New York Times' website, and they often do cool stuff like this. But it's probably a little small for you to see in this case. But this is a video right here that's waiting for us to play, and its thumbnail is an animation. Can you see that it's snowing outside the window? And it's a looping animation, but with the snow you don't really notice that it's looping. I thought that was awesome, and I took that idea and ran with it at Squarespace. I wondered if it would support animated GIFs as a thumbnail cover, and it does, so go watch how to do that. It's pretty slick. This is an interesting article. You know, just 10, 15 years ago, Kodak had 300,000 people creating film, making film in their labs. Some 40-odd buildings across all of these campuses in Rochester. And now it is 300. Is that right? 300,000? That seems like a really high number.
Well, those numbers aren't on this particular article.
I think they're in the video. I watched the video. Okay. You should watch the video. It's well done, well shot from the New York Times. You know, I appreciate it from that fact alone. But just the fact that it was this gigantic campus, 40 buildings, I'm pretty sure I'm right on that. And many of them have now been torn down repurposed for other things. And they're trying to make it a strong technology center that isn't Kodak focused, because clearly. But they talk a little bit about some of the things Kodak's doing now, like developing new touch screens, and they try to be very exciting and very upbeat. But the general feeling I got from the video is it's kind of doomy and gloomy there, for whatever reason. Well, because lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of people are now out of work or have been over the past 10 years, and the area is a little depressed.
Yeah, and actually we're going to be talking about film some more during our discussion. So stay tuned for that.
Mm-hmm.
Next... some sad news this week. Paul C. Buff has passed away. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Paul C. Buff, but he was sort of known for being this guy who made very affordable lighting products. So the Einstein, which is a battery, is it a lighting? I can't remember if it...
It's a strobe.
Yeah, okay. It's a strobe. And what I'm thinking is the Vagabond, which is the it's a battery pack that you hook up to the Einstein that, mm-hmm. you know.
Oh, yeah, and it's the Alien Beast, too. I thought that was
and
right.
And the Alien Beast, right. That's yep. right. The Einstein was kind of like the high power, I think, higher end of the line. Mm-hmm. And lots of modifiers and things like that. I actually have a couple umbrellas. The umbrella that we're using to light this actually is a Paul C. Buff umbrella. Which is really nice.
Yep. So he was, he started off in the music industries and then got really interested in photography and decided to make his own lighting systems and here in the USA and start selling them. And they're known for good quality and reasonable price, too. I mean, you might look at this and say, well, $250 or $224, but for the quality you get here and the power, it's really nice. Now, could you talk a little bit about why you would use something like what's on the screen here, Christina, as opposed to a flash?
Yeah, when you need a little bit more power if you're shooting outdoors and it's really bright and you don't have, you would need like probably 3 speed lights in order to be able to match the intensity of the sun. You would probably want to use one of these Alien Bees. And then some of them are a little bit low powered, so you couldn't do that, but I believe the mm-hmm. Einstein and then a couple of the mm-hmm. More high powered Alien Bees you can use to light your photos outdoors, sometimes in full sun. So,
right. So here's the portable
power. Yeah, so that's
power.
When you may not want to use a speed light.
Right. So if you're out and about, you need to grab one of these giant batteries, and you've actually carted some of these around before. They're quite heavy.
They are. Not these ones in particular, but some other, some different brand. But they're, you know, some of the very powerful ones are very heavy. I mean, not very heavy, but like 20, 30 pounds. And that's just for a battery.
Right. They're kind of like a car battery.
Right.
Right. To give enough power and enough fast recycle time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that boring you, Bean? Sorry. Bean is bored by our discussion of those.
Alien bees. Okay.
I saw somebody in the comments ask, you know, can you talk a little bit about having cats and camera gear around? And it's not good. Their hair gets everywhere. Try to keep most of the stuff up high on shelves and, you know, don't have open lens camera bodies around. There was a conference or a workshop you went to a couple years ago where they offered free cleaning. And what did they mention? What'd they say? Tell us.
Lots of hair
on your sensor.
Not on the sensor, inside of the body.
Oh, it's better.
Well, you know what? The thing is that you should just be careful and keep lens caps or body caps and lens caps on your gear. Anyway, even if you don't have animals, because you'll get, the dust will get in there.
Right, yep.
And, I mean, it may be smaller, but enough builds up and then it starts affecting image quality, so...
Right. It's not something I would stress about a lot. You just, you know, keep your gear closed up for the most part and away from where your animals spend most of their time. Like, don't store the cat bed and your collection of lenses next to each other. And, I used to stress a lot about dust on the lenses and sensors and things and wipe off what you see and just keep shooting. It's pretty rare circumstances that you end up with situations where your pictures are really affected by a hair or two in there. But next cat I get, it's going to be hairless. One of those cute hairless cats. Mm-hmm.
Those are cute. Very cute.
They need somebody to love them too, okay? Just keep that in mind.
Yes, they do. I know. I love all animals. Okay, moving on. And I didn't take the time to read all of this. I just mostly looked at the pictures. So this is
Well, that's mostly what I did too. This is just fantastic. The Gear Patrol has this beautiful page they put together of Hasselblads in Space, or the history of Hasselblads in Space. And when I say that title, I really feel like I need to say it like the old Muppets, Pigs in Space, because that's what it makes me think of. So, just some fantastic pictures. And it's kind of, I didn't really read this at all either, but I just want to share some of these pictures with you. It goes through all of the from pre-Apollo missions all the way up to the Apollo missions, all the pictures taken by them. And they're just kind of fantastic, and they have this wonderful medium format film look to them.
A lot of them are really soft, too. Which is, I'm not saying, I'm not criticizing this. I'm just, it was an observation, which I'm sure it was really, really challenging to take pictures in many of these situations. So, I mean, I think these pictures... you know, the content of them weighs far more than the actual technical skill put into taking the pictures. But some of them are pretty amazing.
Yep. And there is the blue marble photo that has become one of the most iconic photos in history. It's pretty fantastic. This one was, is this the one where they got within a few miles of the surface of the Earth? Surface of the Moon. Oh no, Apollo 10. Was where they were scheduled to be within just part of the mission was to be within just a few miles of the surface of the moon. And the NASA engineers knew that it would be very tempting to the astronauts to want to land on the moon. They're so close, just let's land. So they made sure they didn't have enough fuel to be able to land and get back up. And so, of course, the astronauts didn't want to commit suicide just to walk on the moon, so they didn't. And then we've got Buzz here. This is a super famous picture, tucking his aviators in, and he's got that Omega watch. It's pretty slick. Yeah, it's a good point that, you know, a lot of them are quite soft, but, and then we've got coming down onto the moon, Buzz again. And it keeps going through. This link is down below the show notes, so make sure you take a moment and take a look at it, because it really is a lot of really cool pictures.
All
faked, of course. They're all faked.
So Amazon had some news this week. They released an unlimited everything plan for how much per year?
$59.99 a year. That's a fairly fantastic price. That is unlimited, no file size limits that I saw, and as much as you want to upload. That's the good news. Now the bad news is the terms of service does state that photographers should not be using it for their business. This is personal use only. So if you're a professional photographer making some of your money, you know, how can they really tell? Well, they probably can't really tell, but you know, if you're sharing out galleries constantly to a lot of different people, then maybe they'll get an idea, and depending on the amount you're putting up there. Your guest appearance is over, Bean. And the other, and this is the bigger one for me that makes it an issue, is that the upload window is terrible. Let's see. Let me open the Amazon Cloud Drive app and show you. Because the first thing I did was I downloaded it, and then I dragged a big folder of videos over to see what the speed was like. And it is extremely limited. So if I put this over here and then share the screen with you, this is it. This is the little app. You can then drag and drop something on there. So like, oh, here's that picture of me. And yeah, there it goes. So there's no automated system like CrashPlan or Dropbox or Mosey. There's nothing that's watching folders for you and saying, oh, new content, let me back that up for you. You have to do this manually. And for your workflow, there may be a way to fit that in to work nicely, but it's not really going to be something that I'm going to get excited about. Now, some of you might say, well, didn't they already have unlimited photo storage? Yes, that was unlimited photo storage for Prime members. But now this is unlimited everything for anybody if you pay $60 a year. Free three-month trial. I'd say go try it out. You do have to put your credit card in, though. It's not like the nice Squarespace folks where you can just try it out, and at the end, if you haven't put your credit card in, it's fine. This is one of those ones where you got to remember to cancel or they'll start charging you. So you put a little note in your calendar to remind yourself to cancel it if it's not working for you. I don't think this is going to be part of my backup solution. As a Prime member, though, I do use the photos as another place that my smartphone photos automatically back up. You can run that app to have them backing up. But it's getting a little redundant at this point because I actually use Dropbox to do that and Google Plus both. So I don't really need it to do that. So, okay?
Okay. Next up, we have a video that I have not watched. But the title is 2,600 Miles of Hiker Selfie. So
yeah, so this is a guy who hiked the Pacific Crest Trail. And, you know, there's other people that have done this before as well and done nice selfies of themselves. But what I like about his, and we're just going to watch a piece of it here for a second. I'm going to jump forward. Is that he did a really good job. I don't know if he did post-processing for this or not. But if you look at, like, the bridge of his nose remains almost exactly in the same place for every photo. And that, I think, makes this for a stronger time lapse. It is less jarring, and he's there, and you can kind of take in the background better and watch his beard grow and then his beard go away when he shaves it. And I just really like, he obviously started in the southern part of the trail. For those who don't know, this is in California. Well, California, Oregon, and Washington. And it runs up along the those mountains in California to those mountains in Oregon and Washington, the Cascades. I know the name of those. And it's neat to watch the changing of the scenery and the temperature and things like that. But if you're going to do something like this, follow his lead. If you're going to take a picture of yourself in the same place, I remember it was a couple years ago where these were really popular. Like somebody would publish, they had taken a picture of themselves every day for 5 years or something. And the best ones were all, they had made sure they had locked in on that spot.
That for a second. Test one, two. Let's change it back to that.
Check, check, 1, 2, 1, 2. And it's coming back. Okay.
Sorry about that.
It's USB. Okay.
You know, I don't know.
It's coming back.
Okay.
And it's, well, it's back now. We can start talking, but you know, they're delayed by 15 seconds. Sorry about that.
So
you were saying why you're blogging.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Google likes it when your website is updated because, you know, it's more current and whatever. And it just ranks higher in Google search resource in the organic results. And for me, I just kind of wanted to offer some more information about some products to potential customers. And most recently, I'm working on a blog post that has some information on how to prepare for pre-wedding sessions or engagement sessions.
Nice.
So
I should share those out when you're done.
Maybe.
Maybe. Okay. Long story short is blogging is a great way to bring people to your site, especially for photographers. We've got these kind of static galleries. Somebody comes and looks and says, oh, that's very nice, and then they go off someplace else. But if they look at your pictures and they look and see, oh, you got this cool write-up about how you did this picture, that's nice. And one of the frictions to blogging is kind of thinking about the content and getting all the content into the site. And Squarespace, to make a long story even shorter, makes that very easy and very painless. It's frictionless blogging. You can even do it from your smartphone and even an Android. And I really appreciate that as an Android user that they have an app for Android as well, not like these Periscope and Meerkat folks. But from my phone, I can create a nice post with videos, with image content, and it's just so easy. Drag and drop functionality is all there. And as I mentioned last week, Google is starting to crank down the sites that are not mobile ready. You're just not going to get as much traffic because the number of people on mobile devices is growing rapidly. The amount of traffic I see, when we had our little behind the scenes B&H tour, we were talking to them about their internet traffic and the number of people buying stuff off B&H on their mobile devices has skyrocketed in the last 2-3 years, and they've got a really nice mobile web presence as well. But Squarespace's stuff is all mobile ready. You can plug it into little Google's tools and say, is my site mobile ready? And they'll say, it is awesome. Actually, Google says, it's awesome, mobile ready.
Yeah, actually, you know, I've been looking at the, ooh, that's a really nice website.
Yeah, let's take a look at it for a second. It's Angie, she sent it to me today. And Angie, you're in the chat right now, so you can tell the people that are in the chat, and then we'll echo it for you. I imagine that this was fairly painless to put together, and you've done a really nice job. Very clean. This is what we like to see from photographers' portfolio sites. It's clean, it showcases their favorite images, and it works really well together. I think I actually didn't look at any of your portfolio. I just went through and looked at your info and blog page, and yeah, these are nice. And Squarespace does this work for you. You get the images up here, it fits them together nicely. And Angie, you've got some really nice shots up here as well. Oh, I like the little ring on the pine cone.
Nice
work.
That's
cute. Nice work. And
love your logo too.
Yep, very clean. You've got a nice blog. You're about a month out there, Angie, so you should be updating that. But again, a nice series of photos with just a little bit of text that gives Google something to grab onto, some keywords to launch, like where these people were, where the beautiful Victorian bed and breakfast at Preston Woodall. Those are key to helping get your information out there. If you just put up a site with some pictures on it, it's not going to get found. It's not going to generate that. I like this line right here. Angie Cruz Photography. Don't let the name fool you. It's actually two people, but it's named after the most talented team member. That's similar. You just haven't said that. Because it is all Christina Bernal's photography, but it is a two-person team. Right, honey?
Correct.
Okay, good. Let's make sure.
Except for when you go to Iceland with McKay Photography Academy and leave me stranded to shoot weddings all on my own.
Somebody's got to go to Iceland and talk to these good people about how awesome it is and go with some of these good people. Some of them might even be in the chat room. I don't know. So that's exciting. keeping up with social media in general is, it is hard work. And you got to figure out what works best for you. I'm just seeing John's post in the chat room about that. You were just watching a webinar briefly today on some of those ideas. Facebook, their recommendation was, if you're only going to choose one, choose Facebook. It makes me cringe a little, but that's where the people are. So.
Yep.
Okay.
So let's move on to our discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And as we had previously sort of teased, we are going to be talking about this article that, how did you come across this article?
Roy found it.
Thanks for finding this, Roy. I skimmed through parts of it, but for the most part, I read it, and I thought it was very interesting. The article is titled, What I Learned Processing 164 Rolls of Film After Waiting a Year. So this guy shot a bunch of film for a year and didn't develop a single roll.
Yep.
For the whole year that he shot it.
That's right.
And so he goes on to talk about basically his process of shooting film. And he is a street photographer.
Mm-hmm.
So he shoots with a couple of different film cameras.
Right.
I believe he shoots with a small contacts rangefinder and a Leica rangefinder.
Sorry, I know I'm going through real quick. I thought he mostly takes stuff with his Leica.
No, he actually...
Oh, okay.
Okay, maybe he does, but yeah. I think he ended up saying that he likes the contacts pictures the best because it's a much more inconspicuous camera.
Right. Well, let's go through his benefits. And yeah, very few of us are serious film photographers. Some of us also have film cameras in addition to our digital, but I think there are benefits and takeaways, and that's kind of the gist of this article and why it's written, that digital shooters can use to take away from this article. So what are the benefits of waiting so long to develop film? Which I think is a little ironic, because one of the things is you gotta wait any time amount of time when you shoot film is interminably longer than if you were shooting digital, because it's instant. There it is in the back of the camera. All right, so number one, shooting film helps me stay in the moment. Yeah, it does, because you're not looking, you're not trying to readjust based on feedback you're getting from the camera. You are saying that this is the shot and you're focused on getting that shot. Yeah, I think that is certainly a lesson that we could. You can, I've recommended before, you could turn your LCD review off if you wanted to try to stay in the moment more.
But the temptation and the it's right there, so you could at the push of a button have access to that. And whereas like with film, you have no choice. And I really do believe that, well, for me, I think that has taken, I don't want to say it's taking the fun out of it, but I certainly will be less likely to pick up the camera just for fun nowadays, because I do tend to overthink the picture rather than just, you know, look at a moment, capture it, and then move on to the next thing.
I'm weirded out because my computer just got a lot quieter. Like, it's not working nearly as hard, but it seems to still all be streaming just fine. All right, shooting film makes the editing process easier. Well, that's true. When we shoot digital, we're shooting a fantastic number of photos, and then we do often have to post-process those. When you're shooting film, you really are limiting yourself and making those shots count, spending a lot less time post-processing, a lot more time thinking about the shot. So, yeah. Good. Shooting film helps me relive experiences more vividly. Well, I don't know. This feels a little like a filler.
That is not true.
What's not true? That it's a filler or helps?
No, I mean, it's a completely different experience. Oh, and here comes the other cat.
Yeah, here comes the other cat.
It's a completely different experience to take a bunch of pictures for a whole year on a film camera. Don't not see what any of them are and then get back all of the photos developed, because you'll have forgotten about a lot of the pictures that you took, and you'll be able to see them from a different perspective. And one of the things that he says he's found, or that he's discovered, is that, or one of the arguments that he makes for doing this is that once you've removed yourself from the emotions you felt when you took the picture, you are able to better objectively critique and break down that photo and give yourself feedback on it, as opposed to being close to the time when you took it and feeling really attached to it. So I think that's a really good point.
Okay. Okay. You've got it. Shooting film helps me have a consistent look. Yes, I think this is serious. Now, you can, you can shoot digital and make sure that you post-process images the same way. But as I was saying in my most recent Lightroom episode, I go back a couple of months, especially a year, and I've learned new techniques and styles of editing that I often anxious to apply. And so you can really see a difference in my pictures over time. Not necessarily for the better, but just, well, yeah, for the better, but also a difference. They have a different feel to them in a lot of cases. So if you're on this kind of long-term project, that can be very tough to work with. Whereas if you're shooting film, and in his case, he's really talking about with this setup right here, this Leica and a little flash.
And Portra 400.
And Portra, the same film. That's important too, because you could be throwing different types of rolls of film in. Extreme, like black and white versus color, but less extreme, like Velveeta.
Velveeta. Not Velveeta. Do not put Velveeta.
That was another article I read today about Conquesa recipes that got me hungry too. So I think you're going to have this really kind of consistent look. And that's cool. That's very cool and has a lot of power and weight to it as well. All right. Shooting film helps me avoid gas. For those who don't know, gas is gear acquisition syndrome. Oh, yes. So easy to do. You want this lens or that lens with your digital, or you want the next body upgrade. You know, like they make us want these fancier cameras like the A7 Mark II. With in-body image stabilization, you quickly acquire all of the stuff and you spend time watching videos online about what is the best and getting it when you could be out shooting with a camera that does a good job. And when you're shooting with a film camera, things are simpler and you don't. Now, I mean, that's not to say you could shoot with a film camera and still be acquiring gear and things like that, but I think your focus more is on making the pictures. Okay. Film looks better than digital.
In some situations, if you know how to shoot film, and I have found it from my experience in shooting medium format film that it's not as easy as just metering and pointing your camera and shooting. I mean, film is very finicky and very particular about, you know, variations in exposure and light, and you know, once you take the picture and the film gets developed and scanned, you're working with a JPEG, so you're unable to really tweak it the way that you would a raw image. So you have to really, really be careful about the way that you shoot it. So I mean, I know that Portra, for example, some Portra films, if you overexpose them, and then they are developed, you'll get completely different colors. You get super saturated colors, and it won't be, you know, that kind of Portra look that's very, I don't know, like pastel-y and
muted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So,
all right. Film has more longevity than digital. Now you're supposed to say something.
It does. And actually, this is actually quite relevant for this week, because, well, why I released a page on my website about albums, and you know, recently we were visiting my parents, and I have a pretty young brother, and we were looking at pictures of me when I was a kid, and then we were looking at pictures of my
cute kid.
Other brother when he was a kid. And then we went to pictures of my youngest baby brother, and there weren't any in the box of pictures. And, you know, there are a lot of pictures of him that were taken. I took pictures of him. My other brother took pictures of him. My parents took pictures of him.
But right. It's not for lack of being photographed.
Right. He was very much photographed. They're just online on a hard drive somewhere. And, you know, yeah. And the thing is that digital media changes over time. Like, you know, JPEGs might be the thing now, but who knows what files we'll be working with, what kind or what
JPEG
media types we're going to be working with later on, how we're going to experience them, what devices we're going to experience them on, will they be compatible? Whereas you print a book of pictures and you show it to somebody 50 years from now and it's going to look the same, they're going to experience it the same. Maybe you'll get a little bit of fading, a little bit of yellowing, but you will still see the pictures and it'll still be there. So that, yeah. I think that is an argument for really making sure you print your pictures.
Right. And, so you don't have to shoot film, but you could print your pictures.
Right.
Right. Yep.
Exactly.
All right. And then he goes into the details of shooting film, how to order it, how to travel with it, all of that stuff. I'll let you read all of that. But I thought that was really interesting. And as I said at the beginning of this, I think digital shooters, I'm not telling all of you to go out and start shooting film, although there is some value in that as well. But I think take some of these lessons, internalize them, and apply them to your digital aspects of photography. Yeah?
Yep. And I think so. I'm seeing some people in the chat kind of saying, well, one person saying, I don't know why people are concerned with the other ways that people shoot. And I don't think we're saying that either film is better than digital. And I think this is this guy's preference, mm-hmm. as he's not necessarily saying that it's better.
Right. Some of those benefits work for him.
Right.
Yeah.
But I do, I mean, I think I see a lot of his, I agree with a lot of his points. Whether or not that's going to make me want to shoot film more and whether or not I think it just, the expense is justified for me personally, mm-hmm. I don't know. But right. I do definitely agree with him
right.
in many.
Well, some of the things as I feel like I'm becoming a more confident photographer, things that have helped me that appeal to me in this article is trying to be in the moment more, not stressing necessarily about what I'm getting on the back of the camera. And that's part of confidence of knowing I'm, you know, getting, knowing where, sorry, seeing that experience in the viewfinder and being enough to know that what I'm getting in the scene with wherever my exposure meter is what I want to get. And then the second thing is, and this is something I'd really like to work on more that points out is, you argued that, you know, a year later you can vividly remember these scenes. It certainly is true. I come home from something, I will download the images, pick my two or three favorite keepers out of 100 or 200 or 300, share them off somewhere, and then they're kind of forgotten. Yeah. That's one of the reasons I like Time Hop. You know, it's a little silly, but it's that app that reports back to you what you were doing 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 years ago on this day. And it's an app and it's an email that you can get. And I like that because it shows me these pictures I took a year ago of people I care about or the cats when Liam wasn't quite as chunky. So we're like, wow, he's really gained weight in the last 2 years because look at this picture. He didn't have that belly. But I would like to be better about that. And part of the way I want to be better about that is as I'm going through these Lightroom videos, I'm realizing one of my goals this year was to be more organized in Lightroom, and I'm getting there, but still, it just would be so nice to have my entire catalog all in one place. I've got four catalogs for various reasons, better or worse, all worse. So.
And also I just want to say, who was it that said this? Steven said that digital allows a user to shoot more, but not necessarily keep more prints, mm-hmm. which is another one of the points, I think, that because you shoot more, you don't take as much time. And, you know, I don't want to make a blanket statement and basically imply that all of you guys and then me and you, Toby, that we all just take pictures without really thinking about it. But
spray and pray.
I do think that if you are shooting a roll of film that costs money, that it's going to cost money to develop, I mean, you're paying like $2-$3 per actual picture, you're going to take a lot more care to take each individual picture. Like maybe you will take, you know, a bunch of digital pictures and then end up with a really good one. But with film, you actually are forced to slow down, not just because of the limited number of frames that you have, but also because you know, because it costs money and because the camera is different in itself and the process is just a little bit, you know, different. So, yeah, I mean, you take fewer pictures, but you keep more of them, which is actually kind of ironic. You know, your keeper rate, I think, when you shoot film, or it has been when I have shot film, is a lot higher than when I shoot digital. So I think that's another argument.
Liam heard us talking about it. He wanted to come in and say he is just big boned. So I saw Bill, I think it was Bill, said he's been told to take his cards out while traveling through airport security. You know, I've heard that rumor before. Every time I really go researching it, I don't find any support for it. I have traveled lots with the cards inside the camera. Now, the McKay folks say to take batteries out, but they've had issues personally with batteries inside their cameras when they fly. I've never experienced that personally, and I've flown a lot with batteries in it, but they say it's happened, and they recommend strongly to take your batteries out in the air. Not so much through the security as much. I don't know. I also realized that I had the screen sharing when I held this up. This is a review unit that came in today. It's the Sony A7 Mark II with that in-body image stabilization, and I'm excited about taking that to the Pacific Northwest on our trip. That's what I'm going to mostly be shooting with. And the other exciting thing that came in... Sorry, Liam. The other exciting thing that came in is the Tamron 15-30. Holy moly, that's wide. You want to see how wide it is? Go look at the Facebook post that I posted just a few hours ago of me like this. And that was taken super close and my head looks ginormous. I mean, I have a big head, but 15 is very wide on a full frame, very wide. I'm really excited to shoot with this lens some as well. And I noticed this week, I was watching the video for Bruno Mars' Uptown Funk. Actually, it's somebody else featuring Bruno Mars, Uptown Funk. And they shot parts of that video where all of the guys lean in for dance and then lean back out with an extremely wide angle lens. Because you can watch, it's very quick because they cut away as they're getting further back, but their hands and their arms just get crazy long when they're further away. So the other thing I had, and I mentioned this last week, the other thing I had on the discussion list was weatherproof cameras. And there was an article here at Tobinators. That sounds like it should belong to my URL. I am the Tobinator. About somebody running into an issue with the Sony A7R. It got damp. They feel like it really just kind of got damp, a little bit of drizzle on it. Mm-hmm. And it started acting up a week or two later. They sent it into Sony. Sony said, a lot of moisture inside and, you know, we have to repair it. And they charged them for it. Like, well, you know, what does weather sealing mean? And I think I just want to caution people that I put a lot of more weight on that than we should. And my 5D Mark III, which is supposed to be weather sealed, I had issues with it, remember?
Yeah.
And I don't think it was because I was using a non-weather sealed lens. I believe, and in that case, it got pretty rained on. It was raining hard at that wedding and I was out in it several times. And it got rained on. Kind of like a sprinkler can. Well, that's too much. It wasn't a sprinkler can. I'll just say it got rained on. And it started acting up within a week or two and then had sent it in and they said water damage. And I did get charged for that, didn't I? Yes, that was
it. You did.
I had to pay for that. So
it was out of warranty.
Yes, it was out of warranty. So I just caution people. I feel like we put a lot of weight on this weather sealed. Oh, that camera's weather sealed. And, you know, in some cases, I don't know how much more it means than others. It does not seem that there is a standard. There's standards for waterproof, where they can say, you know, this can withstand 30 minutes under at 5 meters and things like that. They have those. But weather sealing does not seem to have any standards that I've been able to find. And different cameras, I believe, are weather sealed at different amounts. And sometimes that means a lot of moisture won't be able to get in. Sometimes that means dust. Be cautious. That's what I want to say about that. I do know, and I mentioned this several podcasts ago, a while ago, that the folks at Lens Rental took apart the 7D Mark II. And that camera, the original 7D, we've talked about it before. You had an experience where it got drenched and dried it out in rice and it was completely fine. They did say the 7D Mark II looks to continue that. It is extremely weather sealed. I know. I'm sorry I said those things.
We didn't get dinner tonight.
No, I did. Yeah, I did. We have on the checklist of things to do to prepare for this show, feed the cats, and I made sure I fed the cats.
Guess we just didn't shut the door.
We didn't shut the door.
But that when they don't come, you'll ask for them, so.
Yes. Yeah.
Be careful what you wish for.
Okay.
Okay, so now we're going to move on to questions.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to get us started there?
Sure. First question comes over from Facebook, and Mary just picked up some extension tubes, which we love, especially these Velo ones. Amazon and B&H both sell these, and they are smart extension tubes in that you can continue to have autofocus and aperture control. You pay about $80 for it. The cheaper ones, like they have ones that are basically the same for $10 or $12, but you lose aperture control, which really, and autofocus and image stabilization, which really is a kind of a pain. But she asked the question and she said, you know, I want one-to-one magnification. You know, how do I know which size extension tube to put on to get that? And I actually honestly never really thought about this. I just kind of throw one on, and if it looks good, I go with that. And if not, I'm not trying to be too precise, but there is a cool calculator at the folks at Cambridge in Color, and I'll share it with you. You need to know a little bit of information here. This is Cambridge in Color, macro extension tubes, close up, and they've got a little calculator. You gotta put in the native magnification of the lens you're working with. Now, she asked specific, she's got the 51.4. The 51.4 has a 0.15 native magnification, pretty lame. It's not a macro lens, that's fine. If you don't know, plug in 0.15. That's a lot of lenses, but you can just Google it. Then you put in your lens focal length and you put in the extension tube amount. You hit calculate and it will tell you what your new magnification will be. Now, earlier I had sitting on this table, I was just kind of playing around with this as I was thinking about this question, and I put the 31 extension tube, which is actually still, sorry, it's out of the biggest one, it's kind of the same size as both these together, on a 35 millimeter lens. The close focusing distance and the distance at which you have to then focus was that. My finger had to be that close to the lens for it to be in focus, or I was playing with this wood wall back here. It literally was up against the wood wall. So on some lenses, when you get close to that one-to-one, it's just not gonna work well based on the minimum focusing distance. So you gotta keep that in mind and just kinda try to play around with it. Use that calculator, figure things out.
Yep.
Yeah, very handy, $80. They're good too. If you have not watched my macro video, it's long, but I cover all of these options in there. I should add this as a little note below that video because that's handy.
Yep.
Yep. And even easier is a lens actually, as Siri says in the chat. It's true.
SB wants to know, any idea when the replacement for the A6000 is due?
No, this was a question from last week I think we didn't get to. No, we talked a little bit about new Sony cameras that are supposed to be coming soon, and the A6000 replacement is not one of those listed, but I do kind of expect that we'll see it soon. I just don't know when. The Sony NEX7 is on super sale at B&H right now. $498, I think, for that, which that's a great sensor. It's a getting older camera now, but that's a lot of camera for not a lot of money. I don't know. Don't know when the A6000 is coming. Maybe we shouldn't answer the questions. I don't know. I would expect in the next 6 months we see a replacement, if not next 3 months.
Cooper wants to know if we know of any program that can fix lens distortion and vignetting for video, like Lightroom does for photos.
Final Cut Pro has plugins that will do that for you. It even will do fix for GoPros, even that wide. So check, Google whatever editing program you like to use and lens distortion plugins. And I if you use a real program, not like iMovie, there'll be options for you.
Chris wants to know what the best lens is to pair with a 70D for smallish size jewelry photography.
What's smallish size jewelry?
I would try the macro tubes. But also, I guess I wanted to add that I feel like, you know, while you do need to get those macro shots, I feel like jewelry photography, in my opinion, is most successful when it's on somebody and you're sort of see the person that owns it, you know, like in
live modeling,
just lifestyle photography, you know, if that makes sense.
Right. But that's not all practical. I think well, that's kind of weird sometimes if you go on eBay and there's somebody selling a ring and it's on somebody's finger.
You'd be like, no.
Did they chop that finger off there?
I mean, you're not going to just photograph the finger. You're going to photograph the hand doing something. You know, it's like, that's how.
Okay. That aside, if you want to get close, the cheap option on a Canon, right? It was Canon 70, is the 60. Slightly upgrade from that, which will let you get tighter and a little bit better quality, is the Tamron 90, is very good for the money. You want to get super serious, the Canon 100mm f2.8 IS USM lens is just fantastic. Love, love, love that lens. Honestly, is it that much different than the others? No, it's not, but it's good. And if you, the kit lens, both 18 to 55 and 18 to 135 are both capable of getting fairly close. If you've got those, try them first. See if it'll work for you. The trick with those is you're going to need a little bit more light, because those, as you're going to get your maximum magnification at the maximum focal length of that lens, and both of those maximum focal lengths give you f5.6 aperture. So you're going to need more light. The benefit of going with one of those prime macro lenses is you will need not as much light. But here's a little thing, and some of you guys know this. When you get closer to that 1:1 magnification, even your f2.8 macro lenses are not actually at f2.8. They lie. They close down because of the way that magnification works, and they'll go as high as f4. So.
Yep.
While we're talking about aperture, real quick, I stepped in it a little bit last week, and I mentioned somebody had asked the question about they wanted a 70-200 f2.8 on their crop sensor camera, but wasn't it going to be a 70-200 f4 point whatever or 5? And I said, yeah, but you know, just buy the lens for what you want. I should make clear that I was referring to depth of field. Your depth of field on a crop sensor at the same aperture as on a full frame sensor is not equivalent. Can you do that math so easily and just get that nice number and say, oh, it's whatever? Kind of. But it's not the issue with exposure. That's separate, different, it's not an issue. Your exposure is what your exposure is. And some people nicely commented and said, you know, I really don't agree with that whole Tony and the discussion. And I agree that Tony has valid points, but I think in general, it's really kind of confused a lot of people and made them focus on things that don't have that much of an impact. So we were talking relatably, you know, like if you're, I always look around to reach for a lens that's not nowhere near. We were talking about this at dinner with Megan and Bryant about, you know, it's frustrating for beginners lenses that can only be used on a crop camera still report their full frame equivalence. And it's just kind of annoying. It's like, well, wait, you mean this 18 to 55 that can only be used on a crop? Why are they telling me it's 18 to 55? It's not actually. And we talking about, and somebody, it was funny, somebody commented like a night or two after we had this conversation at dinner that said, you know, what we should be using is the field of view equivalencies, because that would be a nicer way to compare these different lenses. So I thought that was funny. So I just wanted to say that, make that clarification there. I'm not saying Tony's wrong. And honestly, I haven't watched one complete one of any of his videos that talks about this, because I personally start to get confused about it and say, you know what? I don't want to focus on this, so I'm not.
You put in this big question here.
Did I put in a big question there?
Yeah, so last week we talked about
Back to this.
Yeah, So the video...
Fusion. Everybody shooting video. As I say, we're going to be doing in the future. We're all going to be running around shooting video and pulling stills out of that. And people have commented back lots of different really good rebuttals to that. All very nicely, like, you know, thoughtful. And I appreciate that. And I'm not, you know, I'm not saying this is tomorrow or this is in 2 years or even 4 or 5, but I do think that we will be there. And one of the issues somebody mentioned was shutter speed. You know, you are more limited in shutter speeds when you're doing video work. And that's true. But, you know, I think we're going to have technologies to get around that to some degree. This person said, you know, the big... Video is shot at 1/30th of a second. This isn't going to work for lenses at even 100 millimeters, right? Because remember, your focal length, your shutter speed should be at least your focal length, if not a little bit higher, to avoid camera blur. And video hides that nicely. All of your frames can be a little blurry because the motion kind of hides that. And that's true. But folks, remember, you don't have to. The rule of thumb for video, wow, this could be a confusing conversation very quickly, because one thing I'm saying is for still photography, the rule is your shutter speed should be higher than your focal length. So if you're shooting at 30 millimeters, your shutter speed should be at least 1/30th of a second. This is pretend no image stabilization. Now, for video, I'm saying your shutter speed should be 2 times your frame rate. So if you're shooting 24 frames a second, your shutter speed should be about 1/50th of a second. Well, then what happens if you're shooting with a longer lens? Well, again, I just said your motion of the frames kind of blurs and hides that. But you really can jack that shutter speed up. You can shoot your video much higher. Some people say that it's jarring and you get this more jerky, static, or almost strobe-like view in the video. It really depends on your content of the video, how much movement is happening. But there are videographers I respect that say they throw that rule out whenever they need to get what they want. Sue Bryce's partner, who does a lot of that video work.
Oh, yes.
You know, she said she just shoots at whatever. And there have been times where, because of the light situation and not having good access to an ND filter, I'm at up a 1/600th of a second shooting video. It looked fine to me. I know I'm less picky than some people out there, but... that's an issue. Another thing they said is, what about in low light? You know, you're shooting with flashes going off. How are you gonna do that with video? You can't have a flash going off a bajillion times a second. No, my answer to that is technology is gonna come along like it has already with the Sony A7S, and we're gonna be able to shoot in these crazy low light situations with clean ISOs. This is now. I'm talking 5-6 years down the road. So. Yeah. And again, I'm not saying 100% this is exactly how it's going to be, but it's going to help. It is what I'm saying. It's just a matter of time.
Yeah, that is what you're saying.
It's just a matter of time.
It's not.
Right. And other people have pointed out nicely that there's a huge component of good photography is what you have, the eye and the artistry and knowing. And if you're trying to shoot video and then you're having an algorithm pull that out, whew.
Plus you approach, like I said last, how many times have I repeated myself? But last time, you know, you approach video from a very different perspective than you approach photography. You know, it's they're different mediums.
Right.
So.
Yeah. But I think there's going to be a fusion of them.
No, it's fine. Okay. I'm done talking about it.
Well, somebody else said, you know, I think the best approach would be have somebody shooting photo and somebody shooting video together. Well, that happens at a lot of weddings, and some of those times people are working together and create a fusion product. I didn't make this name up, fusion. It's been used in other ways before, people doing both of these things together.
Yeah, but they're still treating video and photo as separate things. They're complementary to each other, but video isn't replacing photography. They're both being cut together to tell a story in a different way.
Yep.
I personally don't love fusion. I think it's just strange to me, but I can see why some people might like it. Sure.
Yep. Eugene's got this question in here, and I actually already answered him, but I thought it was good for people to hear. He's got the 85 f1.8 for his 70D, and he's seeing a lot of chromatic aberration when he's shooting wide open. And, you know, when he stops down a little bit, so closing down from the maximum aperture, it's going away. But wide open, it's got a lot of chromatic aberration.
I just missed that question. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I have a lot to say about this because
He's got an 85 f1.8 and he's seeing a lot of chromatic aberration wide open.
Yeah.
Wants to know, is this common at this focal length?
Yeah, and with this particular lens, it is. I have owned that lens. So actually, we still have it. And that was one of my biggest issues with it, was the chromatic aberration. It's especially at 1.8. Mm-hmm. You just kind of have to watch for your, you know, high contrast areas when you're shooting wide open. And Lightroom does a pretty good job of correcting chromatic aberration.
You show that in episode 2?
Yeah, we go over in episode 2 of our series.
We got something to sell now. We're going to sell it because it's good. And its value is awesome.
But, yeah, so that is a common problem with that lens.
Yeah. Well, I would say it's a common problem with more affordable primes that open wide. And even the Canon, I mean, any lens that opens really wide at those wide apertures is more prone to chromatic aberration, purple and green, depending on its focusing abilities. So you just kind of remove it or stop down when you can, or watch out for those high contrast areas, as Christina said. Osmond's got a question that I don't have an answer to. Does the Color Checker Passport D&G profiles work with anything other than Lightroom? You've invested in the CyberLink Photo Director package and can only really use the Color Checker for white balance. I'm sorry, Osmond, I don't know. I would be shocked if it didn't work with things like, what did we mention last week that somebody told me, or Dalibor mentioned that it has several different, what did we say, Naked Kim Kardashian, she was in that, what was that pro? Capture One. Sorry, I had to walk through the memory.
And what was your, never mind, let's move.
I was nudging you because you're always looking at the chat. I just saw Roy's cursor in the chat. Roy, you're going to give us an answer because Roy has worked with those different color checker things a bit more and has written a really nice article about them. So he might have more to say about that. Osmond, ask on Facebook if we don't stumble onto an answer here in the next 2-3 seconds. So I would think it does work with other programs. I don't, CyberLink Photo Director, I don't know much about. Sorry.
Do we have another question?
I think there was, we're close to wrapping up.
We
only had one audio issue, so maybe we should end it. But no, there was a couple more questions on.
In the meantime, Ivar wants to know, is it worth it to buy an original battery grip or should I get a third-party version for my D7100? So not the same camera, not even the same camera maker, but I have an original battery grip for my Canon 5D Mark III, and you have a third-party grip for yours, and they work just fine. I mean, the buttons feel a little bit differently, but...
Do you remember the time I had that freak out about thinking that the tripod... I use a black rapid strap often, and that connects at the tripod hole, and when you've got a third-party, you do want to make sure that it's well-made there. That's the only thing I'd caution you for. I really think that most of the time... It is fine. I'm trying to get to this thing. This is something, you know, mentioning not loving Facebook. I have this thing where Facebook will not let me open up the comments under a post. I can click it till the cows come home and it won't open. Clean browser, no funny extensions running, nothing. Does that happen to you people out there too? It's fussitating. It's very fussitating. I got nothing. Can you pop over to Facebook for a second? Because there was one or two more good questions that I didn't pull over besides Mary's.
And in the meantime, do you want to answer Roger's question? Is there any cure for the white outline around a subject with a blue sky background, or can it only be fixed in Photoshop or GIMP?
That's right. No. When you've got that, I remember you had a crow or a raven, a very dark object photographed against that bright blue sky. And I don't know what causes that, and I don't believe that there's any real fix other than taking a little time to do some post-processing on it. Now, the thing I would think is that at normal viewing sizes, not pixel peeping sizes, that it really doesn't show up. And at normal prints, probably not super noticeable or noticeable enough. See, we as photographers, we take these shots we're excited about, and then we start to zoom in, and our excitement levels drop in proportion to our zoom factor. That's an inverse relation there. Because, gosh, you know, even when we shoot a wedding, we shoot at a higher ISOs a lot, and you zoom into these images, and they are noisy. But we're printing them at 4x6s, 5x7s, 8x10s, with a little bit of noise reduction in Lightroom, just a little bit, they look fine. Zoom back into 100%, they do look noisy. Zoom out to normal viewing sizes, they look fine. So I
pulled up the questions.
Oh yeah, Ursula, what do we mean by medium format camera? Can you address that?
Yeah, so medium format relates to the size of the sensor itself. So a full frame camera has a sensor that is the same size as a 35 millimeter frame in a roll of film. Medium format refers to the film format that's slightly bigger than 35 millimeters. So there's several different sizes of medium format, and then there's large format. So medium format, there is six by 4.5. So I think it's like 6 millimeters by 4.5. No, that's too small. There's 6x6, so it's bigger than a 35 millimeter size. So in that—
So large, 24, I look Wikipedia to the rescue. Larger than 24 by 36
so
millimeters.
40 millimeters.
Smaller than 4x5 inches, which is considered to be large format photography. It's medium.
Yeah. So did you
why don't we call full frame small format? And then we got medium format, and then we got large format, and then we could have extra small.
Well, because it's called 35 millimeter.
Okay, What was the other thing you were asking?
Well, I was, 6 by 4.5 is 60 millimeters by 40 and a half, or?
I wasn't listening. You started to do math and I didn't.
So 60 millimeters by 60 millimeters as opposed to like 35 millimeters by like 24 or something like that. So, yeah, it just refers to the size of the sensor and what that has an effect on in terms of image quality. Not necessarily image quality, but it just gives you a greater depth of field. The bigger your sensor is, the greater your depth of field. So, and that's when we go and we start talking about how different size sensors affect the look of your camera field of view. So with a medium format camera, you have a much larger field of view than you have with a full frame camera. And the full frame camera, you have a much larger field of view than you have with a crop sensor camera. So mm-hmm. on and so on.
Yep. I saw Bill in the chat room ask a good question. What is the max, or a question I want to address? Not necessarily a good question, but what is the max ISO suggested for a camera like the 70D? It's not an easy question to answer, and I'm not saying that as a cop-out. It really depends on the content of your images. Certain images with good exposure can nicely hide a lot of noise. If you're gonna have a lot of shadow areas in your image though, shadow areas versus a nicely exposed image where there isn't a lot of area in shadow can be a much higher ISO than that image. Those shadows are gonna show a lot of noise, a lot of chroma noise, it's gonna have that color look to it. If you can turn it into a black and white, which hides a lot of that chroma noise, that can help as well. I would not love to shoot with a 70D above 3200 ISO. Preferably, I'd stay in the 1600 range. 2000 is fine. 2500. They're definitely noisy, but they're usable. And so then it also means, what are you going to do with this image? You want to print a 30 by 40 poster? Well, then you want to try to keep your ISO down in that case. You're going to just share it online, print it at normal sizes. You can go up to that 3200 ISO, I would say. But again, somewhat dependent on content as well. Sorry, can you pull the, there was the question. The one question from Lee in the Facebook was, similar to the one that I addressed talking about the Tony Northrop and aperture issue. When buying a lens for APS-C camera, do we account the crop factor for focal length? Yes. Do we also have to do that for aperture?
Yes.
Yes, if you're trying to figure out what your depth of field equivalency is going to be. But again, don't get caught up on it because it's not perfectly mathematical. I mean, yes, you can say, but what it looks like is not perfectly mathematical, right?
What do you mean what it looks like is not perfectly mathematical?
The look of your depth of field is not going to be identical if you match up, you compare a crop sensor at a crop sensor at f1.2 versus a APS-C at f1.2.1.
I'm really confused.
Yeah, I did a good job of confusing you there. If you do the equivalencies and say, okay, to get the same depth of field, I need to shoot at X aperture on this crop camera and X aperture on this full frame camera. These are, that's two different X's, or X and Y, we'll say, right?
Mm-hmm.
To say we'll get the equivalent depth of field, it's not going to look the same.
No.
Okay, that's all I wanted you to say. Right. It's going to be very similar, but it's not exact enough. And in my discussion last week with a woman who had asked this question, is like, what are you going to do about it? I mean, I guess it means, okay, if you really want to get a wide aperture when you're shooting on a crop camera, maybe it means you're going to pay a little bit more for a lens that can open a little wider. That's really all you can do.
Right, but then there's a limit, though, because if you buy, a 1.4 maximum aperture lens, there's not really that much wider you can get.
Yeah, it's true.
So you are
unless
limited.
You spend a lot more.
Right.
Right, yep.
Well, even then.
Will Phillip wants to know if he can buy a cheap ND filter and be happy, or does he need to shell out the big bucks for the expensive one? I'd try the cheap one. Some of them are fine. I've read some testing. I have not made any comparisons myself other than I bought a medium-priced one. I kind of went middle of the road, and I've been happy with its performance. I've read some of the very cheap ones can add some kind of color casting and some banding, but the ones that are, that get decent reviews on Amazon and B&H that are in the $30 to $50 range, they're fine. They're fine. And sorry, can you go back to Facebook? There was one more question there, and then we're going to wrap this up because like usually,
oops,
we're hungry. Oh, you clicked the back to 2011. I don't think we had many questions to answer from back to 2011. They probably were things like, what is better, the T3i or the D5100? It's fun to get those time hop things because it shows me what I tweeted too. And I'm like, the D5100 just came out. And that was exciting times back then. Another thing I want to say is, again, I had that little rant about DX snow mark scores, and everybody's just trying to figure out what I just said, who didn't see that, about we obsess over these scores, and really what we need to do is get out shooting. And you go back 5 years on Flickr. Go tell Flickr to show you pictures from 5 years ago. You're going to find some fantastic photos that were made by these cameras 5 years ago that were like, oh my God, their scores were so bad compared to scores today. Yes, remember, it's what you're doing with your camera for 95% of us. So few of us are pushing our cameras to the limit. And you could say, well, you want to make it easier for yourself so you get the camera that can perform a little bit better and help you along as well. But I just don't want people to get caught up on the aperture bit of crop versus full frame and the DXO scores. Things like that. Okay, Dale says, when shooting video, and I don't have a good answer for this either, but I want to throw this out here. When shooting video using a DSLR or mirrorless camera, I notice the video looks jittery and soft when slowly moving the camera or panning. Most noticeably when shooting at 24 and 30 frames per second. It is far less noticeable when shooting at 60 frames per second.
There's a term for that, isn't there?
Well, that's rolling shutter. I think he's seeing. It's curious to me that he actually says it seems more jittery at those slower frame rates. Because those slower frame rates should make things a little more softer and fluid and cinematic. A lot of people say, I want to get that cinematic look. Well, part of what they mean is shooting at that 24 frames a second. The other part of what they mean is that huge amount of post-processing that people don't realize happens to video to give it that kind of cinema feel. It's just funny. So I don't have an answer for Dale in this, except he may be talking a little bit about some rolling shutter in there, but I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't have read it. So
Well, isn't that what the answer is? That's the rolling shutter that just happens.
Oh, right. Oh, DSLR. So he sees it less noticeable at 60 frames a second. She just clicked the more button. But he wants to be able to shoot at 4K, and he can't do that with the GH4 and the T5i. He's used every shutter speed combination he can think of, and it doesn't seem to fix the problem. Any suggestions?
I mean, isn't that so...
Defocus a little.
Didn't we... Who was it that... Was it the slow-mo guys? That we watched that video where they showed how this... this happens. Because when you're taking video with these cameras, you know, what happens
it's
is...
Reading the sensor.
Right. So pixel by pixel. So by the time that you've moved the camera, it... It's reading the pixels that are just slightly over to the side, right? So it's gonna get a slightly angled capture.
Right, that slow-mo video is super cool. Because in that, they show the shadow of whatever's hitting the guy on the side of the face, a balloon or something, is not in sync with where it is, because by the time it got down to this in this really high speed, there's that gap of time. It's fantastically awesome. But I don't know if that accounts for jitter. Jitter.
I think that's what he means, though. It's that rolling shutter. So that's what he means by jittery.
Yeah. I would say, Dale, that I wonder a little bit about the playback. Well, you say you don't see it when you're shooting at 60 frames a second. All right, so there's times where you don't see it. Yeah. Buy a Phantom. Super high speed. Okay. And Andres J says, when can we expect a review of the 760D? I got to order it. I plan to pre-order it soon. I'm not worried about being behind in line. So I get it when everybody else gets it. I don't get special treatment like that from Canon or Nikon or anybody, really.
So George is asking, how should you charge your battery? By using...
I think it means, should you always drain it all the way and charge it back up?
Oh, I see.
That's what I'm going to assume you mean, George. And every once in a while, it's not a bad idea to make sure it runs all the way out before you charge it back up. But honestly, the likelihood that you're going to upgrade before, as I just said, make sure you do not care about your gear so much and just shoot with what you got. Just charge it up. Every once in a while, from dead, but mostly charge it up whenever you need to.
Yeah.
I recommend everybody have at least two batteries. Two batteries.
Yeah.
There's nothing worse than going to pick up your camera for capturing a cute moment and not having one. So we leave battery and chargers. Well, we have lots of batteries, but we leave batteries and chargers, and we put them in there as whenever we need to. We don't worry about making them all the way down, draining them. I'm fading here.
Yep.
Hunger pains.
That was it.
Are you looking at me?
Yeah.
Oh, I was making eye contact with them.
Thank you, everybody, for watching another episode. Next week, we are going to be away, so there is not going to be a mishmash, but definitely tune in the week after. And next week, we're actually going to have our very first Raw Doctor video, so look out for that.
That's right.
And if you
Nurse can... Toby, Dr. Christina... We're going to fix up your raw photos. Send them in. I wanted to put on face masks and lights and stethoscopes and say, Doctor, I don't know if we can save this image. And then Christina would say, don't worry, I got it. Pass me the exposure slider. But she was like, that's too goofy. I don't want to be that goofy. Well, okay. We won't be that goofy, but it's going to be awesome. Raw photos have been coming in. I've seen them dropping in there. There is a link. Where do you go? You go to photorec.tv/rawdoctor. All one word, spelled correctly. And you drop your raw files into that little drag and drop spot right there. And we will be fixing them up. So it's a little critique, a little mashup of, as we like to do mishmashes around here, of critiquing and showing you tools and techniques in Lightroom to make your photos better. The first episode will be out next week. Drop some files in there, please.
Yes. And now we are going to go have dinner. And that's it.
Okay.
We will probably be lingering on the chat for the next couple of minutes, and Bean's getting ready to come back and pester us a little bit more. But yeah.
Right.
If you'd like to stay in touch with us, check out our Twitter and Instagram.
That's right. Especially follow us on Twitter and Instagram as we travel. We certainly, I have more time to Instagram when I'm traveling, and we'll be taking along this nice Wi-Fi enabled camera. So you'll be seeing shots directly from it to my phone. And we'll be shooting from this as well. So follow us along on our travels. And we will be somewhat, we're staying for a period of time at some place that does not have good internet. So maybe out of contact a little bit. Roy and Ruby, I'm just letting you know that now. So I may not be answering many questions and rely on you a little bit more, but you can handle it. I know you can, because you have been. It's a pep talk for people who don't need a pep talk, because they're awesome. So when will we be back doing this? Next Friday, which is what, April 10th, we'll be back answering your questions, talking about your photo news, sharing our vacation photos.
Yep. And are we just gonna keep on finding very mundane things to talk about, or are you just gonna say goodbye, everybody?
Well, this is what happens. People come along and they look at this and they're like, oh my god, it's an hour and 40 minutes long. I'm not going to watch that. So we should end it. Last thing I'll say is updated podcast info. iTunes and Stitcher, although Stitcher seems to be updating very slowly, it's all running. Well, except for the Stitcher updating slowly. You can listen to us on iTunes, and we would love for you to leave a review so other people can find that and say, hey, who are these people and what are they talking about? So, yeah. Yep. And I think on that note, we'll say thank you for everybody being in the chat room, for asking awesome questions,
you,
and
everyone
participating and hanging out with us on your Friday night, Saturday morning, or if you're not watching this live, whenever. And we've got the Lightroom videos for you to go check out. The Squarespace video, go check that out. And give it a thumbs up if you want to see how I turn a video into a GIF in Photoshop. And that's one of the reasons why that Creative Cloud is so nice, because you get that Photoshop and Lightroom and you can do things like that easily.
And we want to know what you guys want to see. What sort of videos, what sort of series do you guys want to see us do? Whether it be tutorials, whether it be, you know, more editing stuff. What do you want to see? Post it down below in the comments and let us know. We really want to take, you know, we want to customize this as much as possible for you all.
That's true.
You know,
we've got a lot on the list, but we'd like to know. Yes. Yeah. Yep.
And somebody, we're talking about content, not about like,
what else
aesthetic
say?
Or audio issues. So
hey,
keep,
you know,
those.
There they are. Just talk about that for a second. So, you know, I think the dropout is USB audio. It just is not extremely reliable. So why not pipe this device directly into the camera? I did that and I get horrible, I don't want to say feedback, it's not feedback. I get a horrible high-pitched squealy noise when the HDMI plug is into the GH4, which I has to be for running this live show. I'm gonna try after I next round of gear review stuff from B&H, I'm going to try out an audio device I've been wanting to review for a while that may give us that quality that we want or not. So, interestingly enough, I complained about the Tascam US322 being kind of loose, but I've got these extension cords running into it now that fit really tightly, so it seems more like it was the end of the sure things that were really loose there. So, all right.
Okay.
Now, it's time to say goodbye.
Goodbye, everybody. Thank you again for watching. And now it's the awkward part when we try to find the live control room and stop streaming. And there it is.